Random House Audio presents Paul Newman, A Life, by Shawn Levy. This is Marc Cashman. Shaker Heights was a dream within a dream, part Garden of Eden, part Camelot, part World of Tomorrow. It had lawns and trees and winding roads and handsome homes and golf courses and some of the nation's best schools and rapid transit into the heart of a major city. Its parks were slices of raw wilderness left unspoiled and right at hand to enjoy. At its heart, Shaker Square was a modern, well-appointed shopping district built to recall a New England village green. The town was among the crests of that great energetic wave of American expansion known as the Roaring Twenties. A man who brought his family to live there could count himself a true success, and children born there could count themselves truly lucky. Or so it would seem. Shaker Heights was a cloister, said Paul Newman, who grew up there from the age of two. It happens that he was a restless sort. But it also happens to be an apt description. The town had, in fact, been built on hallowed ground. Shaker Heights stood about 10 miles from Public Square, the traditional heart of Cleveland, Ohio. Originally known as North Union, the area had first been settled in the 1820s by a colony of Shakers, one of those Protestant sects that thrived in young America and that took its name from the physically vigorous style of prayer practiced by its adherents. They called their new home the Valley of God's Pleasure, but it didn't please God for them to thrive there for long. Shakers are, by doctrine, celibate, increasing their numbers only through adoption and conversion. By 1889, a lack of newcomers meant that the once thriving community of hundreds had dwindled to 29 aging folks who could no longer maintain their homes or work their land. They sold their bit of heaven, 1,366 acres, including mills and other buildings, to a consortium of Cleveland investors for $316,000. The land was platted and renamed Shaker Heights, but it lay undeveloped for more than a decade. In 1905, Mantis and Oris Van Swearingen, a truly eccentric pair of Cleveland developers, acquired and built on a few of the unused lots, creating a small village. Within 2 years, the brothers had arranged for a streetcar line to come out to their parcels, acquired the rest of the undeveloped land, and unveiled their scheme for the town, a paradise for prosperous families built along the English bourgeois ideal of the village. By 1920, when the Shaker Heights Rapid Transit Line was inaugurated to speed riders to and from Cleveland, Shaker Heights had more than 1,600 residents. 10 years later, it had swelled to more than 17,000, all living in single-family homes, none of which, per the Van Swearingen's plan, were exactly alike. Among the newcomers were Arthur S. Newman and his wife, Teresa, who invested in the dream of Shaker Heights in 1927, moving with their two sons, 3-year-old Arthur and 2-year-old Paul, into a big but not ostentatious $35,000 house at 2983 Brighton Road. That was a lot of money for the time, nearly $500,000 in contemporary terms, but it was a remarkably flush moment for the national economy, and Art, as he was commonly known, wouldn't have spent it if he couldn't afford it. As secretary and treasurer of Newman Stern, Cleveland's largest and best-liked sporting goods and consumer electronics store, he was a man who had created out of whole cloth a business built on a nation's increased devotion to entertainment and leisure time. The 1920s were a golden age of sports heroes: Babe Ruth, Red Grange, Bobby Jones, Bill Tilden, Jack Dempsey. And Newman Stern could sell you not only all the gear and accoutrements that you'd require to emulate those greats, but also a radio on which to listen to accounts of their achievements. As long as Clevelanders had money in their pockets and free time in which to spend it, the sporting goods and electronics business was sure to thrive. For Arthur and Teresa, the house was a physical realization of the dreams of all those immigrants who had left Europe for America, and a chance to make something of themselves. Arthur's parents, Jews from Eastern Europe, were both born in the old country, as was Teresa herself, a Catholic from Austro-Hungary. But the prevailing religion of the Newman household seemed to be Americanism. Arthur and Teresa set about creating a tidy little family and situating it in increasingly comfortable houses. In January 1924, Arthur Jr. joined the family in the small, neat house on Renrock Road in Cleveland Heights. On January 26th of the following year, in snow and ice so daunting that Art and Teresa dared not venture out, Paul Leonard joined the family. Within 2 years, he was tumbling and stumbling on the floors of the Newman's dream house in Shaker Heights, the only childhood home he would ever remember. Shaker Heights was genteel and grand, yes, but it was still in Ohio, and it provided an Eden for a knockabout pair like Paul and his brother Art. "We would explore lakes and forests," Paul recalled. "You could almost see the Indians hunting there and fishing." The Newman boys and their dog Cleo were outside all the time, even in the coldest weather that the winds of Lake Erie could dish out. Paul especially recalled tobogganing and skating on frozen ponds and scaring neighborhood girls with jack-o'-lanterns on Halloween nights. And when it wasn't wintertime activities, it was organized team sports. Surely the sons of the Newman of Newman Stern would be drawn into team games. In an era when American manly vitality expressed itself so sensationally in athletics. But there was a problem. "My brother and I," Paul would say, "we both went in for every single sport you could think of. And I was terrible at all of them. Really, notoriously ungifted." He played baseball, football, and basketball. But in none did he ever feel fluent or graceful or even able. It had partly to do with youthful klutziness. Boy, was I accident prone. If there was a tree with a creaky limb, you could be sure that was the one I would pick to climb, and snap. But it was partly due to self-consciousness, too. He had developed into a critic of himself, seeing flaws where others might have seen mere ordinariness. Newman was a more or less average-sized boy. But as a young teen, he leveled off, causing him genuine agony in the thing he most loved. "I wanted to play football so bad," he remembered, "and I played in junior high school." Don Mitchell, the captain of that junior high team, had strong memories of Newman's ability. "He played center for us and he wasn't afraid of anybody," Mitchell recalled. "He could really hit people. He was built. He could have wrestled. But he stayed small, and it cost him. In high school, in the ninth grade," Paul remembered, "I still weighed 98 pounds and was about 5'3". So I had to get a special dispensation so I wouldn't have to play with the lightweights, because the lightweights were all sixth graders. And I was fucked if I was going to play with those guys." The dispensation didn't come. He never did play organized sports in high school. But he had started to blossom in other ways, ways less interesting to a rollicking boy, perhaps, but readily noticed by a mother. "He was such a beautiful little boy," Teresa Newman told a reporter in 1959. "In a way, it was a shame to waste so much beauty on a boy." He also became one of those people who struggled against a native reticence by overcompensating, in certain circumstances, as a gadabout or a show-off. He wasn't comfortable in his own skin, but in the right circumstance, he could don another and let himself go. "Paul was the neighborhood clown," Teresa remembered. "He yodeled and sang and acted in all sorts of little neighborhood stunts." His youthful exhibitionism spilled onto the stage. At Malvern Elementary School, he performed as an organ grinder in a class play, bouncing about and singing mock Italian. "I made up in volume what I lacked in tone," he recalled. When he was 7, he appeared as a court jester in a play entitled The Travails of Robin Hood, singing a song written especially for the occasion by his Uncle Joe. "I didn't like it," Paul later said. "I felt as uncomfortable and disturbed then as I do now when I'm on stage. I had one entrance and one exit. I was a big hit. My family was hysterical with pride and admiration." For all the encouragement his mother gave him to think well of himself and to express himself in front of others, Paul Newman's memories of childhood and youth would always be dominated by the figure of Art Newman Sr. For the rest of his life, Paul would speak admiringly of Art's bookish intelligence, his high moral standards, his discreetly but firmly held convictions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.